And you know, show that, that we are all feeling that positive vibes when we look at each other. Every time we finish this meeting, most of them give me a feedback saying that, you know, we'll
have to meet so more often.
Sure. If this can happen a little more often than once in a month, just to, you know, push the limits and make us feel okay, we are engaged in something constructive. It's just a thought. You can all think about it and then let me know and we can organize it again.
Okay. Yes, these days we need it.
True. So it's 7 o'clock. We'll start with the reviews. Naresh, I think yours has been listed the first. I'll go with your review first. I would like Naresh to introduce and review the book Janaka and Ashtavakra, Journey Beyond by Ashraf Karayat. Yes, Naresh, over to you.
This is able to see it.
Yeah.
Janaka and Ashtavakra, A Journey Beyond. The author is Ashraf Karayat and published
by... You need to speak louder.
Yeah, as I said, Naresh, you'll have to come closer to the mic, so that will be more audible.
Okay, Janaka and Ashtavakra, A Journey Beyond by Ashraf Karayat. This book has been published by Rupa. An interesting part is this book has been released sometime in June, July, just after the first or second lockdown. Like just when things were, when the couriers opened. So we could buy it in Amazon. Probably that's when they released this book. And interesting part is the author has researched for about 10 to 12 years on the subject before he wrote this book. And this is his first book. And to start off with, the author himself says that about 17, 18 years back, first time he heard of Ashtavakra was in Sri Sri Ravi Shankar's talks. There are a series of video talks on Ashtavakra Gita by Sri Sri Ravi Shankar. That's when he heard this on this topic. See, a lot of us might have heard about Ashtavakra Gita. This is one of the supreme spiritual books. In addition to Bhagavad Gita, Uddhava Gita, we also have Ashtavakra Gita. So this book is also some people call it Ashtavakra Gita, some people call it Ashtavakra Samhita. In Hindu spiritual dialogues, this is considered it's on par with Bhagavad Gita or almost equal to it. Bhagavad Gita is a dialogue between Krishna and Arjuna. Ashtavakra Gita is a dialogue between Ashtavakra, he is a sage, and Janaka. So it's a dialogue between these two people. And coming to Janaka, who is Janaka? Janaka is the king of Vaideha kingdom, or capital is Mithila. And we popularly know him in Ramayana as Sita's father. And Janaka is mentioned in different places in our scriptures, and also mentioned in Bhagavad Gita as one of the most supreme one of the most self-realized person, yet who is a perfect karma yogi, who is not attached to the fruits of action, yet does all the actions that are required by a normal human being in the course of life. Janaka is a king, so he has more responsibilities than normal people have. So coming to this, to the author, Ashraf Karayat, he's based out of Dubai. He was born in Kerala, did his MA in English literature and moved to Dubai a long time back, 25-30 years back. And for the last 25 years or so, he's been heading his own company. He's an entrepreneur. Plus, he specializes in a few things like mergers and acquisitions. And he's also claimed to have launched a few cloud computing brands in the Middle East. And does consulting and a few other things. And also happens to be a management. Naturally, a management professional. One thing is, unless you are spiritually inclined, you can, would not dare to write about write on a subject like this. So, it's not an easy thing to write. But for somebody who's written his first novel, I think he's did. He's done a fantastic job, like, because we know two things. A lot of us know the story of Ashtavakra. We know Janaka, and there are books on Ashtavakra Gita. There are three separate things which are we come across. At most, we see of like Ashtavakra. As a prelude, in many Ashtavakra Gita books, we might come across the story of Ashtavakra, but never is a story, or at least I didn't come across a story which combines the story of Janaka as a king and Ashtavakra. Like the author has given a context to this dialogue. So Ashtavakra Gita is a dialogue, as I said, between Janaka and Ashtavakra. So the author has given a context to it. The context is that Janaka is the emperor or the king of Vaideha kingdom, and as a king he has to take care of his kingdom. It's a complex thing to do, and the kingdom there is going through a political turmoil. At the same time, he's going through like a lot of family pressures, and a lot of things are not going right. There's an imminent war which is looming from a neighboring kingdom, on the family side, things are not going right too well. Because we have seen and heard of the stories of Swayamvar of Sita and Rama, but before that, as a father, as a parent, as parents, this author has put. Given a good full chapter to Sita, and interesting part is when you have such an accomplished daughter, finding a husband is not a normal easy thing. So it's added pressure on the parents, or getting married, or who could marry such an accomplished person is. Or a devout person like Sita is a question, is a big question. So, and as the story goes, there are different characters. There are traitors in the kingdom, priests. The important characters are Sita, of course, is after Janaka. Sita is the most important character in the story, and. You have Kushadwaja, who is the brother of Janaka, and also the Senapati and the priest of the kingdom, and few other minor characters are also there. Like I've said, when Radhi asked me about, briefly I've told her that it's a light read. Yes, it's a light read if you read only this book. But if you have read this book also, Ashtavakra Samhita, it becomes a heavy read because your mind starts to associate between the two, and the author has done a very good job of bringing in the philosophy part of Ashtavakra Gita in a very light way. He didn't bring it too much. Like some people might think it's a negative part of the book, but I think he's done a fantastic job because he's just left the philosophy part as a teaser. Like if you read this book, you naturally go and pick up Ashtavakra Gita as the next book to read. As far as that is, if that was his objective, he's done a fantastic or a very good job of it. He's achieved it because after reading this book, I actually searched for an old copy of Ashtavakra Gita, which I read long time back. Again, I started to open that book. So, just to go into the story of Ashtavakra. Ashtavakra is a is a son of a very highly evolved teacher, like somebody who's given us a Gita. Like if Krishna has given the Bhagavad Gita, Ashtavakra has given the Ashtavakra Gita. So, but of a different kind. He's a sage. He's a young boy of around 8 to 10 years. Or 10 to 12 years or something like that. He was born with 8 deformities in his body. So that's why the name Ashtavakra. So the story goes that as a child or when he was in the womb, he used to hear Vedic chants and he learned all the Vedas when he was in the stomach or in the womb itself. So one day when his father was chanting the mantras from the womb, he corrected his father. I think his father's name is Kanoba, his mother is Sujata. So his father gets angry and then he curses Ashtavakra that he'll be born with these deformities. So that's why he was born with these deformities, and from a child, he showed very high superior intellectual knowledge and also high level of spiritual but probably he was enlightened from the beginning itself. Ashtavakra is the grandchild of sage Uddalaka. Uddalaka used to have a ashram, and his mother, when I say grandchild, Uddalaka's daughter married his father. So he was brought up in that ashram, and from his childhood, his father was not there. So it was always a mystery to him where his father was. And then this question was very strong, pertinent in him to find out where his father is. So he keeps asking his mother about the whereabouts his father, about his father. But one fine day, his mother Sujata tells him the truth that his father went to the king, to Janaka's court, and then the story goes that he was involved in a debate with one of the top priests or one of the knowledgeable sages of Janaka's court, and he lost in that debate, and so he was from that day onwards they didn't see him. So now Ashtavakra now asks his mother that he wants to go to Janaka's court to debate with that sage who's defeated his father. So, and then naturally there's his mother is worried, but his grandfather, who himself is a highly evolved sage, convinces his mother that it's high time now Ashtavakra goes on his own and reveals himself to Janaka. So he goes there. Janaka is performing a huge yajna, and all the like evolved saints of the whole planet were invited to that. And Ashtavakra, when he reaches Janaka's palace, is stopped by the gatekeeper.
We have one or two more, then we can have an interaction.
Yeah. Gatekeeper, and then there's a dialogue. He convinces the gatekeeper, and then he reaches Janaka, and there is a series of dialogues, a series of conversations which happen over a period of time. And this is called Ashtavakra Gita. It's a highly evolved philosophy. So the context is that the author thinks in these times when we are like due to COVID, we are living a situation of fear, anxiety, tension. This book actually comes out as something liberating, full of knowledge, and a pursuit of something much higher than what we are pressed down with. And this is because the story also goes like that. So Janaka is pressed down with lots of conflicts in his mind. There's a war which is coming up. Whether one action by him can trigger a massive war. Whether to go ahead or not to go ahead is a decision as a king he has to take, because the Senapati is ready. Everybody is ready for the war. And on the family front, lots of things are not happening. But the climax, there's a beautiful climax also. And one more thing is also there's this demon called Tataga, which is harassing in the nearby forest. And none of the kingdoms or none of the armies are able to defeat her. So as the story goes on, suddenly he comes across news that one day Tataka is dead, along with her demonic son. And slowly the enemy kingdom has withdrawn, and all sorts of things are happening one by one. And then enters Rama for the Swayamvar. So before the entry of Rama, like how we one by one things get settled down. So that is how like I put it in a very simplistic way, but that's not exactly how it is. The book puts it in a very nice way, and it goes slightly beyond the Swayamvar and all those things also. But this is where I'm going to leave it. And coming to Ashtavakra, and I want to end with this. Like in Sri Sri Ravi Shankar's talks, Ashtavakra Gita, liberation is spoken, or Atmagyan, or Moksha, or whatever we call it, or Brahman. It's not something very complex. Ashtavakra Gita calls it something which is already there, fish. You have to discover it like a fish which is in water. Like you just don't see that water, that's it. Like Ashtavakra Gita, the word aho is mentioned many times. Aho means wonder. Like it's something like the rose is beautiful, isn't it? That's not a question, that's a wonder.
Yeah. I guess it's so difficult to summarize a book like that. That's the reason why I asked you, are 15 minutes enough for you? But you said that's absolutely fine. So I thought, okay, let me just go ahead and... the room is open for questions or any interactions. Dr. Garu is showing that in there, the Telugu version of it, if you can see. So, I hope everybody can see the other member out here.
Dr. Gari, you have to unmute yourself.
You have to unmute. Okay, good. Unmute yourself, please.
This is Swami Chinmayananda, a Telugu version of his Ashtavakra Gita.
Okay.
Okay. It's a bit difficult. It speaks a lot on Advaita Vedanta. It's a different type of thing that Aham Brahmasmi, I'm different from Shariram ki, the body and the mind. And the soul are all in one.
I understand this Ashtavakra main 8 places where he got deformed is because his father curses him to get that 8 places deformed, because this boy corrects, this fetus corrects him at 8 places when he's chanting the Vedas. That's what
I've seen. Yes, yes.
That is the reason why there's a significance to the number 8, which is what I was.
And Janaka is described as the greatest philosopher ever lived in those days. He is a very illuminated person.
Yeah, true. I think it's a very interesting read.
He has stimulated enough for me to go through again.
Yeah, true.
That's a long time ago. Yeah. Not completed. I completed 40 pages or something like that. Now I'll read again.
Yeah. I also
remember the abridged versions are very short, in fact. We get a lot of abridged versions which are very short.
Yeah.
And interesting part of this. And,
gives a sloka, then he gives that Padavi Bhajan Jesse, he gives the purport also. He gives the explanation.
True.
This sloka.
Yeah.
There is, every word is divided and then it has a meaning and then totally it covers the entire.
I believe the King Janaka people, they don't allow this little boy when he's supposed to enter the court. The king's court. They kind of discount him looking at his age and all that, but because of his eloquence and the kind of the skills he has in knowledge and skills, he gets into the court. Eventually, the king becomes his disciple, if I'm not wrong.
Yes.
Yeah.
King is the disciple. Janaka is the disciple of Ashtavakra. And interesting part about that, I was thinking, why that conversation between that gatekeeper and Ashtavakra? But one thing that clearly comes out is, even the gatekeepers are not so knowledgeable to understand that somebody is a saint. I don't think nowadays gatekeeper would be interested with that job of assessing a person who comes in.
Lovely. Thank you. Thank you, Naresh. It was a very lovely start after a break.
Yeah, you did a wonderful job.
True. I'm glad this time we are recording because last time we missed Naresh and Harsha's reviews along with others. They were two wonderful reviews they've given. Okay.